Some critic said something to the effect of, Tarantino will never be a master of suspense because he's too far in love with minutia.
Like Tarantino's earlier films, Django Unchained has some over-the-top action scenes, which is now a staple of Tarantino movies, but it also has something less spectacular that might even be more exciting. Suspense. When I saw Django Unchained, I was especially on the edge of my seat at the dinner sequence in Candyland. The sequence works as an escalation of unease, suspense, and then fear. This escalation is very engaging and demonstrates how a 23-minute long dinner scene with characters only talking can be so exciting. What makes this sequence so exciting? How does Tarantino manage to keep the audience's attention and suspense going through such a long dinner scene? This is what I'm trying to figure out. That's why I'm going to take a closer look at the anatomy of this scene. I'm going to look at the cinematic tools Tarantino has employed to compose the exciting dinner scene in Django Unchained. Since this dinner scene happens halfway into the movie, here comes a little recap. The movie starts with Django being freed from the German bounty hunter Dr. Schultz so he can identify some men. Django obliges. After this, Django wants to save his wife Brumhilda from slavery. Schultz and Django develop a friendship, and during the winter Django improves as a bounty hunter. They travel to Mississippi and discovers who owns Brumhilda. Schultz hatches out a plan of how they're going to get her back. Schultz will pretend he's going to buy a Mandingo fighter from Calvin, while Django will be pretending that he is a Mandingo expert, there to advise Schultz. At the midpoint of the story, they meet the film's antagonist, Calvin Candy. The plan works and they get invited to Calvin's plantation, Candyland. When they arrive in Candyland, they meet Brumhilda and in secret tell her about the plan to rescue her. Later that evening, it's time for dinner. Up to this point, Tarantino has developed Django and Schultz in a way that makes us empathize with them. This is highly important for us caring if it goes wrong or not, which is the foundation suspense builds on. But it's only a foundation. To create suspense, there has to be conflict. They got a goal? Save Brumhilda from the terrible Calvin Candy. A more interesting element in how Tarantino creates suspense is that he writes stories where the main characters have to pretend to be someone they're not.
You'll be playing a character.
Already before the dinner starts, there's suspense. Are they going to get busted? This is something Tarantino often likes to do with his characters. He has done it in almost every movie he has made.
I gotta memorize all this?
In Reservoir Dogs, the whole movie revolves around a cop who pretends to be a robber. In the nerve-wracking bar scene in Inglourious Basterds, there are Americans pretending to be Nazi soldiers. A trademark for Tarantino is the focus on characters and dialogue. And in this case,
dialogue as a mechanism for suspense.
Not surprisingly, he likes to create suspense, not from only external situations, but from the characters themselves in dialogue-heavy scenes.
And now, Django, you may choose your character's costume.
The table is set, the plan is in motion, and we're now ready to see how Django and Schultz are going to trick Calvin Candy. Like all stories, the dinner scene itself is divided into three acts and is made up of six scenes. Here I will examine each scene as the suspense builds from one to the next. Scene 1 starts with Steven displaying his authority in the kitchen. He continues into the dining room and we get a nice introduction to the dinner party through a long take that lasts over a minute. This take visualizes how the kitchen is located in relation to the dining room, which will become important. They talk about Mandingo fighters, there's a pleasant atmosphere and stability in the scene. The long shot comes to an end at Django.
Samson the champion. The mother too pretty good.
Everyone reacts to his statement. Not only is Django a former slave who now dines with the white slave owners, but he contradicts Calvin. This reinforces how he's like a fish out of water. This sets up potential suspenseful moments, but nonetheless, Django and Schultz portrays their characters skillfully and convincingly. Schultz tells Calvin how nice it's to speak German, his first language, with Brumhilda. He tries to fake a romance between them, so he can add her to the purchase of the Mandingo fighters. But then a hint of the truth surfaces.
I don't know, Doctor. You can lay on all the German sweet talk you want, but it looks like this pony's got big eyes for Django.
For a moment, there is uncertainty for our protagonists. But Schultz skillfully hides the truth by flourishing a witty line. They think they're safe again. No one reacted. No one but Steven. Until now, the Sceens have worked as a setup, but it's not until now that suspense is introduced. This moment in the dinner sequence you would call the inciting incident, which is the spark that will ignite suspense that follows. Without this incident, there's no suspense to build upon, and everything will go according to the plan. But Steven noticed, and now there's uncertainty. Sceen 2, Steven instantly follows up on his suspicion. Brumhilda pretends not to know Django. Steven pressures her, she manages not to crack. The interrogation happens in one 45-second long shot, where both the camera and Brumhilda are standing completely still. Techniques that make the interrogation seem a lot more threatening and intense. After a while, you expect a cut. Either conscious or not, it's expected that something will happen. In itself, this type of editing builds suspense, and the more time, the more you expect something to happen. When the shot is locked down so long, it seems like Steven is observing her. No cuts, he stares at her, he doesn't look away. When it cuts right to Django, not knowing what happened. This is what suspense is really all about. The master of suspense himself said this about suspense. It is indispensable that the public be made perfectly aware of all the facts involved, otherwise there is no suspense. That entails that the audience needs information from the director, and here Tarantino starts to show us. If you didn't show Steven's suspicion, there wouldn't be any suspense, and then the climax would have been a shock. Hitchcock explains the difference between shock and suspense in what he likes to call
bomb theory. You and I sitting talking, we'll say, about baseball. We're talking for 5 minutes. Suddenly a bomb goes off.
According to Hitchcock, this only delivers 10 seconds of shock. But if in the same situation you were to show a ticking bomb beneath the table, that would be suspense. The bomb is just an example, a metaphor for how suspense is created. In the dinner sequence, bomb theory is generally used twice. The first time, Steven becomes the ticking bomb. And when it cuts to Django, who acts like he's a Mandingo expert, it represents the baseball talk. This will be more apparent through the next Sceens. Schultz buys the Mandingo fighter, and then something happens. Steven puts Django on the test by humiliating Brumhilda in front of all of them. The suspense builds by focusing on Django's and Steven's size. Close-ups of Django reaching for his gun, and the scars on Brumhilda's back. Anytime Django could be pulling that gun. But the humiliation is stopped. Django lets go of his gun and looks down at the dinner table. Django is being inspected, and there is rising tension. Now their plan is in danger by the fact that Steven is watching them closely. Sceen 3. Steven confronts Brumhilda and tells her that he knows that she knows Django. Again, Tarantino gives us this information in the kitchen, which Django and Schultz do not have access to. Steven is relentless and hurls questions at her, and when she starts crying, it only confirms his doubts. The atmosphere in the kitchen is so intense and quiet that we hear Dr. Schultz saying,
"Speak German this afternoon with Hildy was positively soul-enriching."
Once more, our protagonists have spoken completely ignorant of what Steven knows about. Steven realizes what's happening. Sceen 4. In the dining room, Schultz is just about to put in an offer to buy Brumhilda as well, and Calvin seems very accommodating. But Steven interrupts Schultz by barging into the room. He asks for a word with Calvin concerning the dessert. Repeatedly, Calvin declines, and the audience can hope that Calvin sends Steven back to the kitchen so Schultz can close the deal. But then Steven leans in. He understands that it's important and agrees to come right away. In Sceen 5, Steven informs Calvin about the plot against him, and when he realizes that he's about to get tricked, the major turn in the sequence, the camera jumps the 180 degree rule. Here the jump works, since it represents a sudden change in story. Calvin realizes that he has two imposters as guests. The first five Sceens play mostly on suspense and unease, but there's not real suspense until there's some sort of threat of danger. And that's exactly what happens when Steven informs Calvin about the conspiracy. And when Calvin reacts like this,
sons of bitches,
then the audience's feelings goes from unease to suspense. Calvin is the threat of danger. He represents danger because of what we've seen him being capable of doing in the scene with the hammer and the slave that ran away. In this scene, we get a major turning point, and Steven metaphorically arms the bomb. Before I move on to the last scene, I want to talk about how the narrative has been laid out to create suspense. How Tarantino has chosen to tell this part of the story makes this sequence a masterclass in suspense. If you haven't noticed, every scene has started with Steven. More specifically, Steven in the background coming into the foreground. There's multiple layers to this. Mainly, it shows how Steven is the true master of the house. Like a puppet master, he works behind the scenes. Steven is the unexpected element who both the protagonist and the audience did not expect. He is the main source for the suspense until now. Like Tarantino points out, for a long time, all the tension is carried entirely in Samuel's eyes. The scene Steven has is also effective when they happen in the kitchen and in the library, since Django and Schultz are ignorant to what's happening. They still believe that everything is going according to the plan. This also reinforces that every time a scene starts with Steven, we cut to our protagonists, trying to advance their plan. That the audience gets all this insight makes a huge difference in what the viewer know and the protagonists. This makes the viewer feel helpless. And just to be in that state when something bad is about to happen can result in higher suspense. Uncertainty is also important in suspense, and it can take different shapes. For example, it can be uncertainty about what will happen, how will it happen, when will it happen, and will it happen? All the scenes until now have played on this one question. Will it happen? Will Steven find out what's going on? Now the suspense transforms in the last scene, and there Callan Candy covers all the other points. We know that something is going to happen because Calvin has now been informed. We know that he's capable of doing terrible things for his own pleasure. And when he finally comes back to the dinner party, the atmosphere is drenched in suspense. As ignorant as usual, Schultz asks once again about buying Brumhilda. Calvin tells Schultz to wait, but instead of Calvin confronting them both right away, he takes his time. He talks about a dead slave's skull for 5 minutes. Why? Tarantino argues that it's more exciting this way.
It's like the suspense is a rubber band, and I'm just stretching it and stretching it and stretching it and see how far it can stretch. As long as that rubber band can stretch, the longer the scene can hold, the more suspenseful it is. That scene is more suspenseful at 22 minutes than it would be at 8. So you want to just stretch it until the rubber band breaks.
And that's exactly what he does. He stretches the rubber band as long as possible by letting Calvin go on with an unpleasant monologue about phrenology, which he uses to justify slavery. And for a while it's unknown where this monologue is going. Again, uncertainty. The monologue becomes more and more threatening. It's clear where this is going. The suspense changes to fear. When and how is Calvin going to explode? The explosion itself is technically done quite well. What Calvin talks about is an indirect threat to Django. It's quiet, we can hear all the tiny sounds, sounds from grasshoppers outside, from the jacket Django is wearing, and the sound of the instrument Calvin uses when he points at the hammer and the skull is loud and clear. This is what you call the pin principle. When you show silence, not by removing all the sound in the scene, but just by highlighting the sound of objects that usually make such a small sound that you can't hear it. Close-ups of Calvin who points at the skull, perfect time to let the bomb explode.
Hey! Lay your palms flat on that tabletop! If you lift those palms off that turtle shell tabletop, Mr. Pooch is gonna let loose with both barrels of that sawed off!
The facade is gone. The suspense still continues in a bit more intense way than earlier. Now it's purely based in fear. What is Calvin going to do?
Bring out Hildy!
All the six scenes put together makes a long and a fantastic sequence with several brilliant moments, which makes it into a roller coaster of suspense, which builds to the climax in the last scene, and then into an intense conclusion where Calvin forces through purchase agreement. In a sudden tone shift, he's back to being normal, and the sequence ends with him politely saying,
"If you care to join me in the parlor, we will be serving white cake."
With scenes akin to this in The Inglourious Basterds, Django Unchained, and ultimately the entire Hateful Eight, Tarantino showed himself worthy of the title The Master of Suspense. hope you liked the video. As I said in the disclaimer in the opening, is that this video essay is like a homage to one of my favorite video essays, Inglourious Basterds, The Element of Suspense by Lessons from Screenplay. It's a really good one. Check it out. I've linked it in the description. If you like this video, you would like this as well. Like and subscribe if you want to see more of these video essays. Bye.